Key, and I'm the director of the Armored Multi-Purpose Vehicle Program, otherwise known as AMV. And as Lisa said, this is the international debut of the AMPV. And so we're going to roll a video for you first, let you meet the AMV. So how cool is my job, huh? Seriously, how cool is it, right? I mean, think about it. Every morning, all through the world, people get up and they don't want to go to work. Not me. I get to work with that magnificent. Says to me, we want to roll out the AMPV internationally. They say, Sheehy, we're going to send you to London, England. Huh? I'm here in London, England to introduce to you the AMPV. Never been here, thrilled to be in this city, but even more excited to introduce you to the Armored Multi-Purpose Vehicle. So let's get to it. First thing I want to tell you about the AMPV is that it is a completely new build vehicle. From track pads up, brand new. It is not a refurb, it is not a upgrade, it's not anything like that. It is a brand new vehicle. The raw materials come in to one end of the facility in York, Pennsylvania, and a few months later, out the back is a brand new AMPV ready for fielding. Second thing I want to tell you about the AMPV is it is not one vehicle, it's five different variants. Five variants, two medical variants, one an armored ambulance, which is on display to your right, my left, and that's a production vehicle right off the line in York, Pennsylvania. The armored ambulance has inside it all of the modern life-saving devices you would find in the most high-end first responder vehicles. Second medical vehicle is a medical treatment vehicle, which is literally a surgical room on tracks, wrapped in armor. There is the 120 millimeter mortar variant. This gives the maneuver commander responsive fires in the close fight. There is also the mission command variant, which for the first time allows the United States Army to take its huge network capability down to the brigade and battalion level. That vehicle, the Mission Command vehicle, also has 17 different configurations inside the vehicle to whatever electronics, radio configurations you want to have. So that demonstrates the modularity of the AMPV. 17 different communications configurations already plumbed inside the Mission Command. The fifth variant is the General Purpose Vehicle. General Purpose Vehicle operates throughout the battle space, doing critical missions like maintenance, resupply, and those type of things. So those are the five different variants that are currently produced by BAE Systems. All that production is done on one line, flexible, agile production line in York, Pennsylvania, that incorporates a lot of modern manufacturing techniques. Robotic welds, radiographic imagery to ensure the vehicle is built to a standard that the Army demands. All on one line. Five variants, brand new build, all on one line. Very complex. BAE Systems has developed the engineers, logisticians, workforce to be able to handle that complexity. Just think about that. Five different vehicles, one line, the supply chain you have to figure out, work instructions, inspection criteria, all of that goes into being able to produce those five different vehicles from scratch on one line. So that's the family of vehicles. The family of vehicles was deliberately and purposely designed to win on any battlefield, under any conditions, anywhere in the world. Hear what I just said. It is purposely designed, developed, and currently being produced to fight on any battlefield, under any conditions, anywhere in the world. That battlefield of today and tomorrow. In order for BAE Systems to demonstrate that to the Army and give them the confidence that that vehicle can do that, the Army arranged a huge battery of tests for the vehicle to go through. Things like over 37,000 miles of RAM testing. That's about 60,000 kilometers of RAM testing. It was sent to the Tropics Test Center, and it was sent to the Cold Regions Test Center to test both ends of that spectrum. It went through a battery of environmental tests, toxic fumes, sand and dust, corrosion, a whole host to ensure the vehicle could fight and survive in any of those battlefields. It also went through 35 different live fire events. Those are events against real threat weapon systems. The vehicle passed with flying colors all 35. And the last two major tests it did were operational tests with the United States Army, extended operational tests with a unit out of Fort Hood and one out of Fort Stewart to ensure the vehicle was suitable, safe, and effective in the roles the United States Army demands of it. And if you need any other proof that the vehicle passed all those tests, as Lisa said, just recently, BAE Systems was awarded a production contract, full rate contract, at a total value of $1.6 billion. So the United States Army is committed to the AMPV going forward. That contract will ensure continued production of AMPVs to the soldiers of the United States Army until middle of 2027. It's a lot of vehicles being built and being issued out to the United States Army. We are currently approaching our 300th build of AMPV, taking this vehicle from vehicle one all the way through as we stood it up. As I said, the AMPV has gone through the battery of tests, and it is not only set up for today's battlefield, but for the future. As we designed a deliberate and purposeful design of the vehicle, we incorporated the entire breadth and expertise of BAE Systems to incorporate all the lessons learned we can put into the vehicle as it goes forward. The most important lesson learned that we built into the AMPV of today is the ability to rapidly integrate new capacity for the vehicle as threats emerge. So the vehicle you see today has the margin built into it to take and accept new capability as threats emerge throughout the world we're in. So it's my job to make sure we are producing on time and that we position the vehicle for the threats as they go forward. And as we do that, BAE Systems has invested internal funds to create what we call the External Mission Equipment Package, the XMEP. The XMEP is a universal top plate that allows us to quickly integrate any number of turrets. We went through a long process. We brought in a number of turret manufacturers from across industry in order for us to ideally design the top plate for a sweet spot to accept the vast majority of the turrets out there. Currently in Sterling Heights, Michigan, we are working on a counter UAS 30 millimeter with a fully qualified turret from a different vendor, and we will have that vehicle on display at AUSA in October. Much like the medical ambulance we have over here, which is a production production vehicle, the vehicle that with the 30 millimeter is not a show vehicle. It is a vehicle that will be, the turret is fully integrated, and we will shoot that in November for the United States Army to demonstrate the capability we have. Additionally, using the same XMEP, Universal Top Plate, this month we will integrate on a turreted mortar, 120 millimeter mortar, for the United States Army. We will hand that vehicle off to them in January of next year. So as you sit here today, we have five variants that are in production and being fielded to the United States Army. Simultaneously, we are expanding the family of vehicles through the use of our internal resources to develop the XMEP and incorporate a number of turrets into the vehicle. The intent is, regardless of what turret somebody wants, an ally or the United States Army wants, we will be positioned to rapidly place that turret into the AMPV and move quickly from demonstration to production. That is what we are working on BAE as we move into the future. The AMPV is firmly set up to take us in there. It is the foundation for the modern combat arms for the United States Army, and we hope that that extends out into the allies and friends. Thank you very much. I'll be followed by Mr. Liam Worthington. Sir?
Thank you. Can everyone hear me okay? Great, perfect. Thank you very much. Yes, thanks, Bill. Great presentation. I'm here today to talk to you about the Archer Mobile Howitzer. Now, before I show you a video which will do more than anything I can describe, I just want to set some context. Archer is a 52 caliber 155mm indirect howitzer. What does that mean? It means we send projectiles that have a diameter of 155mm indirectly to somewhere we can't see at great distances, and they weigh around 45 kilograms. So before I play the video, I would just like you all to imagine that you're now in the Army. You've just been handed over your first fire mission, and this is the length of time it's going to take to conduct that fire mission. You've been told to go to a position or driving over to that position. The vehicle stops. The remote weapon station on the front will lay the gun, telling its position. The spades come out automatically, and the weapon system begins to disengage and ready to come into action. You're into action in 14 seconds. You are now traversing towards the target to which you're going to send the first projectile. 23 seconds, the first projectile is in the air. You're then going to send a second projectile out there. 32 seconds, we've got two projectiles flying at the same time in the air towards the enemy target. 40 seconds, the third and final projectile is in the air. They're all still flying towards that target. The enemy probably knows where you are now with counter battery. But guess what? If they don't have an Archer system, they're still getting into position, and we're out of action in 50 seconds. The barrel is returned to its cradle position for stowage. The spades are then brought up, and you are ready to make your way before the first projectile has hit the target. If the artillery system that we're against is remotely good, it's probably just about to get in position. We're driving away. 74 seconds, we're out of action. You've just done your first fire mission. Maybe the artillery system that we've just hit, or the counter battery, is trying to attack us, but we are more than a kilometer away. Well done on your first fire mission. How easy was that? Now, just to set the context, Archer is the most advanced automated artillery system fielded today. And I'm going to go through a few slides that will describe how it does that. But before I do, I just want to set the context of the environment that we are in today. Today's battlefield is characterized as a multi-threat environment. There are lots of challenges and threats out there, and we need artillery to be as inherently flexible as possible. I would say being able to carry a fire mission is just in 74 seconds is just the start of that flexibility. You've also seen two slides where there's two different vehicle types. Archer isn't a system that has been developed from the ground up vehicle to weapon. We're talking about a weapon system which has been in use since 2016, which has been designed for modularity. We recognize that our customers want inherent commonality across their vehicle fleets. So you've already saw two different vehicle types, the Archer 6x6 and the MAN 8x8 truck. We recognize that you want to be able to retain the pedigree of the Archer weapon system, but potentially utilize the vehicles which are already in service with that army. Before I move on to the following slides, I want you to try and remember these four key attributes that we're going to go through in a little bit more detail. Why Archer is the most advanced system out there. We're going to talk about lethality, mobility, survivability, and endurance. and I'll touch on just why Archer is a step-changing capability what is fielded today. So lethality. Again, I'm just going to go back to the video. You've just saw a fire mission conducted in 74 seconds. I would say that is pretty lethal. I'd also like you to imagine that we've just been given your second fire mission. You're back in the army now, please. You've just been given your second fire mission. Does anybody live near Southend-on-Sea in the audience? No, good, because that's where we're going to hit the next target. It's over 50 kilometers away. We are now qualified with the most advanced precision-guided munition, and we are going to hit that target at Southend-on-Sea, 50 kilometers away. With the precision-guided munition, we will be able to hit that target with an accuracy within the size of this stand. Again, that is lethal to us. This is a pretty big stand. I'd say it's probably going to be half the size of this stand. We are also culminating that with something that BE Systems developed because of the Archer system. So we developed something called multiple rounds simultaneously impacting. What that means is because the Archer system requires automation and a low level of human intervention, you can fire rounds much quicker than was ever seen before. And with that, we can program into the Archer system to be able to fire projectiles at different elevations with different charges. So up to 6 rounds can fire on different paths. So one projectile elevation X going to the projectile, another one in a different elevation, and so on and so forth. You could hit the same target with 6 projectiles at the same time, culminating in almost 270 kilograms worth of heavy explosives. You could also attack a convoy of vehicles, 6 vehicles in a line. You want to hit them all at the same time. You want to surprise them. You don't want to give them a warning sign. So you can fire again 6 rounds, and they will hit different targets simultaneously. Again, a lethality which provides a step change in artillery which is fielded today. Mobility. So I like to split mobility into 2 things, tactical mobility and operational mobility, when we're looking at logistics. How quickly can you do something once you're there, but how quickly can you get there? And with tactical mobility, as you've seen, we've developed Archer so that it's a modular solution. It can go on to multiple various different vehicle systems which are in use with armies today. We'd like to think that if they've got those vehicles in service already, that meets their mobility needs. And just so happens you've now got the most advanced artillery solution on the back of that vehicle. Included in that, I'd like to talk about operational mobility. So yes, the 8x8 vehicle, which is in service with multiple countries now, can still travel 55 miles an hour. It can still go to a range of 500 miles with only the fuel that it has on board. But it also, when it has the artillery system on the back, doesn't require to be split if you want to transport it via rail. If you want to put it in an aircraft, you don't have to take all of the ammunition out in order to meet the weight requirements. If you're going to travel by sea, again, it doesn't have to be split. You're not just going to have a vehicle and a weapon system with a crane on the other side to put it together. We are in this business to deliver an operational capability, not just delivering platforms. The third key attribute to why the Archer system is what we believe the most advanced artillery system fielded today is survivability. And again, I'm just going to go down into 3 different levels of what is survivability. So survivability is 3 things. Susceptibility, how easy are you to be found? Vulnerability, if you are found, how easy are you to damage or put out of action? And recoverability, how quickly, if you are found and damaged, can you recover and become operationally capable again? Susceptibility, you've just saw it before. The Archer system can shoot and scoot, is what we call, in 74 seconds you can conduct a fire mission. But also, what we can do, we recognize that there are UASs around in our environment now, and we recognize there's a bit of a compromise. They're not mutually exclusive. Do you have enough protection to protect the system so that if it is damaged, it's still operationally capable? But are you light enough to be able to shoot and scoot at a speed to not be found? That's the compromise that we've made, and we've got a cabin which is Stanag Level 3 armored protection. I can't go into the details of just what that can withstand, but it's a decent fragmentation. The other side of the vulnerability part is our crew are as far away as possible from the magazines which hold the projectiles. Unfortunately, you'll see a lot of videos now where the likes of tanks are hit and the ammunition within those tanks then ignites and explodes. Our crew are as far as possible from the things that could potentially explode and therefore have the highest survivability rate. The last is recoverability. And just on that, again, I'm going to talk about the modularity. If your vehicle system is damaged, you could take the Archer system off and replace it with another logistics vehicle that you have. If the weapon system is damaged, you can take the weapon system off and either use another weapon system or fundamentally use that vehicle for another purpose. There's recoverability there. You're not just out of action if something's gone wrong. We're also talking about a system which has been in service already with the Swedish Army since 2016. Okay, we have been developing this system all the way through that, and we have been developing the knowledge in terms of making a resilient system. Lastly, I want to talk about endurance, the fourth pillar of why Archer is the most advanced artillery solution out there. We've got an image of the crew here. You need a maximum crew size of 3 to operate Archer, but the human factors in terms of endurance are huge. No longer do you have people sat outside in the environments operating an artillery system. They're in an environmentally controlled cabin. They don't have to withstand the large heats, the cold weathers. They don't have to lump around 45 kilograms of projectiles in order to fire. They're in a much better environment. They can endure more. They're also under less stress. They don't have to worry so much about being hit with counter battery and fundamentally being put in harm's way. They're now in the most protected cabin that is out there today. Also with that, because of the automation built in Archer, because it requires a limited amount of human intervention, it's a lot of computer-based. You've been given a fire mission, it sends a target, you push a button, the Archer system traverses to that target. It doesn't require that much human thinking, especially when you are in a high-stress environment under a counter-battery. And then lastly, on endurance, the weapon system itself. We have 21 rounds in that magazine. We can fire all of those rounds in 2.5 minutes. Every Archer artillery system is provided with an ammunition resupply system as well, which has 100 projectiles. Again, that culminates in a capability of over 5,000 kilograms of high explosive 155 projectile rounds. Again, I would say that is endurance. And if we can limit the amount of times that the crew either is affected by the environment that they're in to conduct their mission, when you want an artillery system to be in use 24/7, we believe the Archer system is the most capable solution out there today. And thankfully, we're not the only ones that believe that. So we are very proud to welcome the UK to the Archer family. They've purchased 14 Archers from the Swedish government to backfill the 32 AS90s sent out to Ukraine. We are working extremely hard across BAE Systems in Sweden and UK to bring those into service by 2024. We're also extremely proud to say that Ukraine is obviously one of the newest members of the Archer family. Again, they have been granted in kind 8 Archer systems from the Swedish government, and they will be coming into use in the coming months. I think the last thing I would like you to leave with this presentation is what you've seen isn't a prototype. It isn't a PowerPoint presentation of hopes and dreams. This is a system which has been in active use with the Swedish Army since 2016. It is the most advanced automated artillery system in the field today, and we believe it provides a step change to our end users, to other artillery systems out there now. So that's my presentation. I'm going to hand over to Dan Lindell, who's going to talk about CV90.
Thank you, Liam. That was an excellent presentation. I'd like to have one myself. Is that possible? Anyway, my name is Dan Lindell. I'm the Director of Combat Vehicles out of BAE System Hägglunds up in the northern part of Sweden, where we have polar bears and excellent combat vehicles. I will focus on the CV90 today, but also understand we have the BvS10. And once I'm finished with my presentation, you all will have a lot of questions, I hope. So at the BvS10, we have the director of the ATTVs, Mr. Darren Risterik. I don't know if he's in the crowd. He's a former Royal Marine and an expert user on the BvS10. And we also have the director for CV90, Mr. Tarkan Turkcan. 31 and a half years in the Royal Dutch Navy, or sorry, Army, and expert user on the CV90 system. So if you have detailed questions, I would like you to go to those guys. But as I said, focus on the CV90. And Bill, excellent video. I love going out there, you know. We've just been out with the CV90 as well to a place that is not very common for me. We were in Brazil. And I can tell you, it's not often as a combat vehicle director, you go 3 weeks on paradise beaches, high-speed cruising with your combat vehicle, but we actually did. Yeah, that was nice. Very interesting experience, I must say. Okay, some CV90 facts. First of all, we have 5 different generations of the CV90, from Mark III to the Mark IV we have here. We are well on our way to do the 7th million R&D hour of the CV90 system. We have currently 7 nations that are firm fixed in the user club. We have the 8th just came in with Slovakia being observers in the club, and additional 2 more coming in very soon, being the Czech and Ukraine. 6 are NATO members, or actually there's 7 now with Finland, and hopefully 8 soon, depending on politics, of course. There's 16 variants of the CV90 in service, and actually there are additional 2 now being built in Norway for Sweden, being the Pioneer and the support group vehicle. So it'll be 18 in about 6 months or so. We have 1,700 vehicles in service or under contract, actually slightly above, and there's more coming in. Until the full-scale invasion of Ukraine by Russia and Sweden's giving away their Mark Zeros to Ukraine, we had accumulated 70,000 days in combat operations. Now we are in a full-blown war with the CV90s. But we have to remember, all versions, all variants of the CV90 are designed to do exactly what they're doing in Ukraine. So far, we have driven more than 11 million kilometers with the fleets within these 10 nations. And because of the security situation, driving and usage of these vehicles are being picked up as we speak. So, I mentioned the CV90 Club. This is actually a quote of the statute from the CV90 user group. Working together to make the CV90 family of vehicles continuously better for the soldier. The CV90 Club is a community of users, not at all driven by industry. It's driven by the customers. There's no annual fees. The users take turn in being the chairman. As of now, it is Estonia, it's Captain Yuri Backhoff that is the chairman of the CV90 group, and they take turns biannually. And as I said, there's 3 new members coming into this within a year, so it'll be 10 users in the CV90 club. And what's it all about? Well, first of all, it is sharing experiences. It is sharing experience from Afghanistan, from Liberia, from Ukraine, from training in the forward operations in the Baltics, NATO. It is sharing training facilities, training means. This means that we have Norwegian and Danish soldiers practicing in the tactics simulation in the Netherlands. We have other users coming into Sweden using our training facilities there, and so on. So actually what you get when you come into the CV90 family is you're tapping into those 70,000 days of combat operations. It's actually a memory of understanding and technical agreements between all of these countries. It's a true band of brothers on all levels within the user group. So, what do we have on display here today? Well, it's the CV90 Mark IV, the 5th generation CV90. what is now under contract for Slovakia and the Czech Republic. It comes with a cyber-hardened fourth generation digital backbone. It has the D-series turret, which is now being produced for the Dutch customer in their big midlife upgrade. The turret can host either 30 or 35 millimeter main guns. It has a mast-mounted electro-optical panoramic sight for the commander. It has an ATGM pod on the right-hand side. In this case, it comprises two Spike LR2, but it can also host the Acheron missile. It has a semi-active decision support for the gunner, what we refer to the eye-fighting, as an eye-fighting concept, meaning that the gunner has significantly reduced cognitive load and decreased sensor-to-shooter time. In a dual situation, that is the turret you'd like to be in. Also, what we can see is that we have an integrated laser warning system and an active protection system comprising of a defensive aid suite. So this is the first combat vehicle in the world that has both the soft and the hard kill system on it. If we look at Slovakian and the Czech contracts, all in all, there will be seven unique variants in that program. Those variants weigh from roughly 33 metric tons to 36 metric tons. However, the Mark IV chassis can host up to 38 metric tons. And that is an increase with 3 tons without adding any weight to the chassis itself. So it's true payload for the customer, the user. It has a Scania V8. In this configuration, it has 860 horsepower. Can go up to 940 horsepower. That's coupled to a CAT transmission, the X300 heavy duty. And something else that is special with both the turret and the chassis of the Mark IV, it's the increased ergonomics we give for the users. And we should remember, the Mark IV is built upon the experience from Mark 0, 1, 2, and 3. And I would say, when it comes to the turret, especially now with the D-series turret, where we've had the veterans of the Mark III, the 15-year experience from the Dutch Army coming back, okay, this is how we would like to change. A perfectly working system, but we can make it even better. We also have active vehicle dynamics, increases the ergonomics, but foremost, it gives you substantially higher terrain speed in really rough terrain. We're talking about a system, a world-class system, a Mark III. There is no better. And we make this vehicle 40% quicker in rough terrain. It's a revolution in terms of terrain speed. It runs on the 7th generation rubber tracks. We have now the entire Norwegian fleet and the Dutch fleet running on rubber tracks, and soon to be both the Czech and the Slovaks as well. To further increase ergonomics, we have slightly larger volume on the inside for both the turret and the chassis. However, the turret is even smaller than its predecessor, so it's larger on the inside, but smaller on the outside. That's design efficiency. And also, to reduce the cognitive load further for gunner and commander, I already spoke about the eye fighting. We have also, with the veterans, the Dutch veterans, the Dutch users, placed buttons, we have different areas where the users actually placed the different buttons. So it's not made by us, it's made by the Dutch user, or designed by. There's something else unique with the Civinita system, and that's the way we do industrial cooperation at Hägglunds. So traditionally, we weld our hulls and assemble our hulls in our facilities in Örnsköldsvik, the northern part of Sweden, and the user nation produces the turret, and then do the final assembly of the turret and the vehicle or the chassis in country. We're taking that a step further now with the Czechs and Slovaks, so more will be produced in country. So that's to solve the industrial cooperation, which is usually a requirement. But what we did as a side effect was actually building a European security of supply. Because in all of these nations where we have our partners, we now have technology of transfer. They know how to build the vehicles. They know how to assemble the turret and the chassis. They know how to source all the subsystems. So effectively, what we have done here, without doing anything ourselves at our facility, we have increased the production of C-90s in Europe by 400%. On top of that, we are doing our own measures as well. So, when it comes to the CV90, it is a very, very capable system, world-class capabilities, but that's not only what you're buying into. You're also buying into a community, loads of information and experience from using the system for more than 30 years, although in different marks. And you're also buying into security of supply. That's my last slide. Yeah. Lisa.
Thank you, Dan.
Welcome.
Hello. One more. Perfect.
Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. We will have opportunities for any one-on-one questions that you have. So please come and see me or Natasha, who sat in the middle, or Alicia at the back, or Ola. Any of us can arrange what you need, and we'll make sure that happens. But are there any questions you'd like to put to the panel right now? Yes, please.
Hi, Alistair MacDonald from the Wall Street Journal. The CV90 is actually in operation in Ukraine, isn't it?
More, yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry.
And then, that's what I thought. And if it is...
Could you refer to the... I couldn't hear you.
Sorry, the CV...
CV90, yeah.
Yes, sorry, the CV90 is in operation in Ukraine, yes?
Correct.
Yes. And I mean, are you getting feedback on its performing? And are you getting any interest from potential customers about it on the back of that? People saying, we've heard it's doing well, we would like to test it out, or anything like that?
So, quickly to Archer...
You said there that it's not in operation yet in Ukraine? It's not in operation, all right.
So yeah, open sources, you can see the CV90 is in operations. And of course, we get feedback, but we're not commenting on any operations that are being conducted by the Ukraine Army.
But in terms of other customers potentially showing interest on the back of that, are you seeing that yet?
Of course, yes. I'm pretty sure that the CV90 Club would welcome Ukraine with open arms because of that.
Nick.
Nick Fiorenza, Janes. A question about Archer. How long would it take to train up Ukrainian crews? And also, as an aside, there were reports a few months ago that a brigade of CV-90s, Leopard 2s, and Archers with Ukrainian crews were actually training in Sweden. Now I'm beginning to wonder where the Archers were actually in that exercise. And then on the CV-90, most of those 70,000 combat days were in Afghanistan, I presume, but you did mention Liberia. And what other countries has it seen combat? Low intensity, of course.
Shall I go first? Can you hear me okay, Nick?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. So in terms of training, I can't give you a specific time, but I will have a colleague, Henrik Napa, who can give you the specific weeks it takes. But fundamentally, Archer in the Swedish Army takes on a number of conscripts training. We're talking weeks to train on Archer. That's how long it'll be, but I can get you the specific how long it takes to train from one of my colleagues. In terms of training the Ukrainians on Archer, you're right, they did train in Sweden on the Archer system, but like I mentioned to the colleague before, they're not in active use right now in Ukraine.
Yeah, and regarding the CV9 and the combat experience, you're absolutely right. Low intensity conflicts, but there were some. As an example, the Danish vehicles themselves saw over 100 IEDs in Afghanistan during their period over there. So, of course, not totally different from what we're seeing in Ukraine, but there's a lot of experience that comes back to us in terms of mine protection and all that in feedback.
100 IEDs
in the vicinity of the CV90, yes.
Okay, but and some damage, I suppose, but not serious.
So some of them are very serious. I cannot go into details.
No, it would not be appropriate for us to comment any further. Nick.
And sorry, just like Afghanistan, Liberia, and what other countries?
Then we have the forward operating of NATO in the Baltic states, but it's not a conflict, of course. No. Yeah.
Okay. And Nick, come and see us, and we'll put you in touch with the team to discuss the training. Okay. Any other questions here? Okay. Well, as I said, we have opportunity for one-on-ones. Come and talk to the team, and we'll set that up. And thank you all for attending, and thank you guys for your presentations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.